A young man by the name of Anthony Nottingham. He's then a keyboard player extraordinaire. Isn't that right, Anthony?
Silence. Well, I'm doing keys tonight, so hopefully, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. He's been on short notice because we did have him booked in for January. January. Then he said, oh, if anybody cancels, let me know because I'd like to do it a little bit sooner. And there you go. Somewhere along the line, we had a cancellation this week. And instead of having sort of like, where were we? Yeah, 4 months or so to prepare, he's had like 4 days.
Six, I think. It wasn't very long. I just go, panic, big panic. So basically this week, I mean, I had nothing ready. I just got the album. I just finished the album.
Yeah.
And this is all to put it on kind of as much live as I can, uh-huh, since you dumped me in it.
You dumped yourself in it. You could have said no.
That's true.
You could have said no. But anyway, so you're up for a challenge, aren't you?
Yeah.
At the end of the day. What's the first track you're going to play for us this evening?
Okay, so basically I'm going to just go through the album tracks in order.
Yeah, sure.
Work quite well, just see how far we get through it.
How many tracks are on the album?
There's 12. There's one that's more of an instrumental, so I'll probably not do that one. But
yeah.
I don't think we'll get that far anyway. The first one's called Summertime Supernova.
Yep. I think we played that one on the show before, didn't we?
I think you played the one called Next, which was quite a rapping one, which we'll get to. This one's meant to be, because obviously I wrote this album a few months ago, so it's the getting into the summertime feel, really.
Gotcha.
So it's all about that.
Sorry to interrupt you. Off you go.
That's all right.
Thank you. You've already attracted some comments. So, shout out to Dan Hicken, Stuart Ingo. He says, sounds great here. Love from Nottingham. Shout out to Mary Kathleen Connie is also watching in. And a shout out to Michael Day. He really, really does like electronic music. Loop Cycle Second says, sounding good. I reckon Weird Garden would like this kind of thing if you ask next year.
Excellent, yeah.
So there we go. So who inspires you when it comes to electronic music, Anthony?
Oh, gosh. Normally I'd say things sort of the 80s stuff, so for all the way from kind of Kraftwerk and Pet Shop Boys, Duran Duran, New Order.
Ah, yeah, you like all the sort of, you know, sort of new, well, futurist stuff we used to call it in those days,
time,
didn't we?
Yeah.
You used to call it futurist stuff, yeah.
Kind of is, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, I'd like all kinds of genres, there's a load of, I mean, you name it, I'd like something from it, but, I mean, what I'm doing here is obviously electronic, but it's not directly based on any of those. This is kind of my own.
Yeah, I can tell you, you know, yeah. We wouldn't accuse you of plagiarism in any way, shape, or form.
Yeah. Like when I put the album out, you have to name three people that it sounds like, which is impossible. I think the closest one I got is, I don't know if you've heard of the stuff Gary Newman's doing now.
Yes.
Yeah, so it's quite heavy and dark.
Yes, yeah.
Almost industrial percussion stuff.
Yeah, he's gone quite industrial in his style of music, hasn't he? Yeah.
So I think the closest one is that, but obviously it's not really like him, but there's a bit of that in there.
I reckon Jean-Michel Jarre, you know, the French composer. Yeah, you sound a little bit like him in a way, I reckon.
Yeah, maybe the synth side of it, definitely.
Yeah.
Sort of he started it in sort of the mainstream part of it.
Yeah, he was another one who was around that sort of time period of the 80s or something like that, weren't he?
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
New film that came out, he'd done like the soundtrack for it.
Yeah. I watched one the other day. I can't remember. Somebody did a sound. It was quite a modern film. Oh, no, it weren't. It was a vampire film called Near Dark, which I hadn't seen for a long time. Tangerine Dream did the soundtrack for that one.
Oh.
You know, so can you remember them? They were sort of another sort of German electronic band.
Right.
You not listen to them?
No.
Yeah, it was worth a listen, Tangerine Dream. Give them a go. Yeah. What's the next one you're going to play for us this evening?
Okay, so the next one is called Home Alone, which is basically about being home. No, it's about... there was a reason I wrote it. I can't remember. The title, I have inspirations, then I forget why I wrote things. But I mean, the basis of this one is just like there's somebody who's got all this potential but can't be bothered. So they're quite... It's not saying they're wrong. They're just happy not doing it and pretending they had.
Yeah.
So it's kind of like that. Yeah. Now, just take me a second to switch a couple of things around. Yeah. That one and that one. I think they're done. I might just have to adjust the level as we're going on this. But there we go. Right. So Home Alone.
Off you go.
We'll be right back.
Most excellent. Makes a good change from having rock bands in the studio. Mary Kathleen Connolly, she says, sounds fantastic, Ant.
Good.
And Michael Days, great sound, loving it, my favourite genre. So there we go, you've got some fans, that's for sure.
Awesome.
So when did you start sort of like playing electronic music?
The very first time I played any sort of keyboard at all was at Sir Harry Smith's in Whittlesea.
Community
and
college.
They had an old analog synth there, which I don't know what it was. But that's the first time I ever played anything kind of synthy, really. Mm. After that, it was the real place that got me into it was A-level college in March at Neil Wade.
Mm-hmm.
And the music teacher there basically had a whole room full of tech. He was really into promoting all that. So that's where I got into Cubase version 1, early drum machines, quiet keyboard programming, stuff like that, which I did with my cousin. So that's really where it started, was A-levels when I was about 17.
So you was quite early, really, weren't you?
Yeah, I guess. I mean, actually producing it as tracks to release. The first one I did was when I was just about finished uni, and I got a sort of a club record deal with this guy from London.
Did you?
I think I said before, and he played it on... It got played on the John Peel show, which...
Oh, very nice.
That's my claim to fame, nothing else.
Yeah.
That's it. Yeah, and that didn't really lead to anything else, but it was really nice to get that. And then I sort of got into it when I was working overseas and just bought some keyboards and started producing and writing. So that was probably more like, what's that, 15 years ago since then. So I sort of got back into it later.
Yeah. And have you still got a vinyl copy of that one that got played on John Peel?
I do. They all got a bit damp in storage, but I've got 3 or 4 copies of it, yeah.
Oh.
I think the records themselves are still pretty much mint, but the sleeves...
Sleeves are a bit tight. Yeah. Never know. It could be worth a few quid. It could be a cult club hit or something like that. Who are we to know?
I think it sold about 100 copies at the time, I think, but it was only released for like the London club scene, really. So I know it got played somewhere.
Yeah.
I don't know where.
You never know. Who may have been dancing to it then?
Funnily enough, I posted it on SoundCloud years ago when I found it on a cassette tape or something, a copy of it. And somebody went, I was on that show as well. They got in touch with me. They're on the same show on John Peel. It was amazing.
There you go. It's the small world sometimes, isn't it? You know, without a doubt. Late great John Peel. I think it would have been his birthday a few days ago.
Oh, right.
Yeah. I think he.
He did a lot for music.
He did.
Ninjas out there.
Yeah. Without a doubt. How long did it take you to make this album?
Not that long, because I didn't have anything else to do.
Yeah.
And I made a commitment to do one track. I think it was every 2 days at the most, but most of them I did every one a day.
One a day? That's some sort of output.
Done 12 tracks. I think it took just over 2 weeks. Yeah. But I was basically full on, get up, do it till bedtime. So I just thought I'd get this done. So,
I like somebody who knocks the crack on and get their head stuck in. That's the way to do it. You'd make it good.
It's like I have to commit to do something, otherwise I'll just do a couple of tracks and they'll get put in a folder and forgot about. But I was determined to do, right, I need to do an album. I haven't done one for a few years, like my own stuff. So.
Yeah. Well done. What's the next track you're going to play for us?
The next one is called Star.
Off you go.
And, it's as simple as that, really. It's a sort of an uplifting track about having confidence to be yourself and get your potential and maybe be a star sort of thing.
Yeah.
Nothing too complicated about any of these, really. That's what it is. I just need to check my levels.
Nope, that's fine.
Make sure I press the right note to start with. Okay, sorted. We'll be right back.
Yeah. Oh, we'll get a bit echoey there. Michael Deeg said he really liked that one. It's his favourite so far.
Nice.
And big shout out to Sly Arthur B. He's watching also.
Nice one.
So have you put this new album on all the streaming platforms and stuff like that?
Yeah, it's out on all the usuals. Yeah. It only came out 2-3 weeks ago, mm-hmm. So it's pretty new. I think it's on most of the sites now. So, yeah, just search. It's called... That would help, wouldn't it, what it's called? It's called Artificial Intelligence.
Oh, nice.
By Ant Nottingham.
Yeah.
And... I did kind of release them all as singles first.
Yeah.
As I did them, it was another thing I did. I thought, how can I get the most input from this? And it's something I've not done before, is when I did each track, I released it one at a time, every one. And it's not helped at all, but it was worth a go.
Where's your sort of largest listeners base sort of thing, do you think?
When I look at the...
All your stats.
It shows it's mostly... There's UK and America.
Yeah.
There's a few in sort of Western Europe, like Germany, Italy, and Russia.
And what platform is the most popular to listen to your music on?
That is, now let me think, that's... I can answer that, but it's not those people. those people, are the stats for kind of this sort of music.
Yeah, sure.
You know, electronic stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
The ones that I've had the most... streams from and therefore revenue, albeit a little bit, is strangely enough the violin looping album I did last time I was on the show. And there's two or three tracks on there that for some reason have just been picked up on TikTok and used in other people's videos like thousands of times.
Yeah.
And I get like 10p every 6 months, but you know. Yeah, that's two off there. Eden and Crazy Morning.
Mm, it's strange how things go, isn't it, when it comes to streaming and all stuff like that. Yeah. There was a guy on our show, he was playing sort of like an Americana. Can't quite remember his name now. And he's had thousands of streams on SoundCloud of the live session. Really, it's Matt, something of it.
Matthew Aylett.
That's it, Matthew Aylett, Yeah, he's had something like 13,000 streams of his songs.
Gosh, yeah.
He's gone crazy on there.
The days have gone of where, when I first started on YouTube, the first year it started, you could put any old rubbish on there, really, including mine, and you got thousands of views, no matter what it was. You're lucky if you get 10 now.
Mm.
It's really difficult.
Well, that's it, yeah, because obviously there's so many more people out there composing and doing music and this, that and the other, you know, so... And I mean, not only that, now they at university they teach everybody how to use these different electronic programs to compose music and stuff like that.
Yeah, it's part of it now. Yeah,
you know, and the music production courses and even the general. I mean, my daughter's had me, you know, putting different programs on her Mac and this, that, and the other, so she can do it and stuff like that. Mind you, they're all rather complicated. You know what I mean? You've got to have a good head on you to be able to do it, anyway. Really.
I get as far as I'll miss one out and do it if necessary. Mm. But there's their track actually called AI, and it's called talking about using technology rather than hating it.
Yeah.
So it's sort of AI. Yeah. You know, is it doom and gloom? Maybe, but you can use it.
Yeah, so of course.
Use it for what you want. When the piano was first invented, did it put people out of jobs? Not really. Creates another.
Of course, I'm totally with you, you know, so yeah. It's like when they, you know, it's like any sort of technical innovation that comes along, there's always doom and gloomers and Luddites, you know, and I mean, really, technical innovation, you know, has been happening for the last sort of 300 years or so, hasn't it?
Yeah.
You know, so...
As long as you can, there'll always be a need for people who can play real instruments, and which I'm... not really doing here, you know, I'm doing a little bit of keyboard,
but
I play violin and piano and guitar and stuff. But people that actually play something will always be in demand if they're skilled enough.
Well, I think a lot of people nowadays, they're into lots of, you know, especially quite a lot of young people I speak to, you know, because I've got a few kids, young kids and friends and people at university and that, they're into loads of different genres of music, and you know, and they cast their sort of gaze wide really when they listen to music, you know. So one minute you might be hearing a bit of hip hop coming out of their speakers, but the next minute you might hear some Eagles or some electronica or whatever.
That's it, yeah. My daughter's the same.
Yeah.
Got the t-shirts are like Led Zepp and stuff, you know, really?
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, my daughter was running around a Rolling Stones t-shirt the other day.
Yeah, got Rolling Stones as well.
You know, so, yeah, but so people do cast them, you know, so...
It's a good thing.
It is a good thing that people got a broad taste in music. I'm like yourself, I love a bit of electronica, you know. My favourite, I don't know, yeah, probably my favourite electronic band.
I'm a big New Order fan.
Did like the last album, Music Complete. That's probably one of their best albums they did for a hell of a long time, really.
Yeah,
since the days of Technique, stuff like that, and then Kraftwerk and my number two, definitely. You know, great band, really, really are. Anyway, that's enough about talking about me. Let's talk about you. What's the next track you're going to play?
Maybe doing time, so I can see how many we're doing. About halfway.
Yeah,
that's cool. I'll just carry on because I like the first six are the best anyway.
You're on the roll.
Oh, that's terrible. People won't get you. No, there's some good ones, but there's a couple that don't really work with my setup here so well, you know.
Yeah.
I don't know if we need to, but okay, this one's called Dreams. What's it about? It's kind of a bit creepy, this one, I think. And I've not like to go with the fact that this whole album's a bit on the sort of AI technology thinking, or about the industry and how it's changing. I did pictures for each of the songs, and this one's got a really creepy sort of horror organ with an old guy looking like a wizard pulling candles on it and stuff.
Mm.
So yeah, that was. It's got a little edge of creepiness, but it's really just about sort of positive dreams, I think. I like sort of doing opposites together.
Mm.
So it's kind of creepy, but it's positive.
Whatever works for you.
That's it. Funny, sometimes I can't remember the song until I play the keyboard sound and I go, oh, that one. Right.
Thank you. Yeah.
Thanks.
Michael Day says creepy, but in a good way. And big shout out to Joe Mokin. Thank you very much for listening and watching the show. You also submit your music to like music banks and stuff like that, don't you?
Not these ones. But
not these ones, no, but other ones, sort of like.
It's what I've been doing really is writing for certain. It's called library music for Sync. And what it is basically TV show producers go to these libraries to find tracks by keywords that will fit their show, when they're like churning them out week by week, usually a quick series kind of thing on Discovery Channel or whatever. So they need music for that show and they can't employ composers because they haven't got the time. So they just grab something. But quite often it's also sent as a brief. So they'll tell you, the library, what they're after.
Yep.
And then the composers that library uses that they know do that kind of music, they'll send it to and say, you've got 3 days to get this film score done. You'll panic and send, yeah, send it in. I've not had too much success with that yet, but we're working on it. I mean, I've had a few placements.
Have you? What sort of shows did they go to?
Cake-alike, where they bake cakes put faces on them like celebrities.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I was on the one with RuPaul.
Oh.
There we go. I think I was on a couple in Australia. Harbour Patrol, and there's one I've forgotten, and I'm hoping I'm on the Discovery Channel's Shark Week, which I think
coming
up very soon.
Do you get your name in the credit?
No.
You do not?
They're like ghostwriters.
Ah.
So they're just all the back, I mean, unless it's written specifically like a theme tune or something, it's literally just background, tension, relief, scary, jovial, whatever. Yeah. So, yeah, I've wrote about 4 or 5 for the Shark Week. I know they got sent to the show, and it's Dwayne The Rock presenting this particular series, so,
You can't beat a good Shark Week, though, really, can you? You know what I mean? Everybody loves a Shark Week, really.
Yeah, that's it.
You know,
and I've got a couple of film credits now, which is...
Have you?
Yeah, so I did the whole score for Aircraft 2, which is like a spoof of Airplane.
Yeah.
So I did the whole sound for that. And I've got a couple that I've got credits for, and I'm not writing the whole music, but I'm involved in it.
Yeah.
So there's one based on the Half-Life games called Ravenholm. It's like their second. They did a short version through crowdfunding, and they're doing a full feature film. So I'm involved in that one. And the other one is a sci-fi, which I know I'm helping out on. Sort of editing and reviewing when it's nearly at the end stage, I'll be helping out and getting credits for that. So that's called Of Infinite Worlds.
Oh, that sounds pretty cool to me. Sounds pretty cool to me.
Bits and pieces here and there.
Yeah, it sounds like you're quite busy to me. I mean, I wouldn't want to be too nosy, but so what do you get? You know, if you've got a track played on a Discovery show, would you want to divulge how much they pay you? Or was that too rude?
It very much depends on what channel it's on and most of all how many people watch it. So you're not talking a massive amount, because we're talking probably 20-30 seconds of a track, and you probably get in the region of a couple of pound a minute. So you're on about 50 quid to 100 quid, unless it's a really big show, then you might get a lot more. But normally it's short clips and not that much. But it is forever.
Yes.
So
every time your music
the
is played.
And repeats, you get, it's not the first amount, but like half the amount or something, but you get that forever.
Yeah.
So it's all about building up a whole load of stuff that's been used, and it builds up and you get more and more.
You're getting like a... I'd say a cheque through the post, but obviously cheques through the post don't happen anymore. You know what I mean? You get a cheque transfer or whatever from...
Yeah, bank from...
Yeah.
I got one the other day, but like, so that's for the... from CD Baby, which I still use for certain things, and that was for the looping album. I still get 50, 100 quid every month... Really,
that's
couple
cool.
Of months, couple yeah, of months, maybe. Yeah, that, yeah. The weird thing is, it's just for those two tracks.
Yeah,
I've done so much, and just those two tracks.
Yeah, but the thing is, sometimes you only need to write one hit, don't you? One big hit, and that's it. You're done.
So,
to argument's sake, we've got Kimberly Roo and Lee K. Berry. Now, Kimberly Roo, he wrote Walking on Sunshine.
Right.
No, no. And that's just one track, and that song, you know, really, he would never have to work again if he didn't want to.
Exactly.
Just off that one track. So really, you just need a bit of luck. Just need just one bit of luck here and there, don't you?
That's
you
the
know.
Thing. Yeah.
And that's it. You know. And I think he actually sold the rights to that track a few years ago.
Oh, okay.
You know, so, yeah. You know, because obviously it's a bit of an investment, because it gets, you know, it can be played, it can ask a lot of money. That track could be like...
Absolutely.
If it's yeah. on a car advert, it could be something like £100,000. You know, so yeah, keep plugging away at it.
That's it. I mean, these tracks could be used on adverts, and that's the more lucrative side.
Yes.
You get an advert because it's played so often. Yeah.
Yeah, and away you go.
Yep.
So yeah, just keep plugging away. But no, you're making great music. So I think you'll make it. You'll make it. What's the next track you're going to play for us?
Time's running out. I'm getting old.
I think you played five. Am I wrong?
Sorry.
I think you're on number five. Track number five.
Yeah. I think it is. It's five or six. Yeah. Right, the next one, I'll give it a go. I might get a bit tongue-twisted on it. It's the one you played on your show. It's quite a rapping one.
Hmm.
But yeah, it's really good.
No, you're doing great.
Play, but I've got to get my words right. Let's just set the keys. I think we're ready. Next. Because it's next. This is sort of a bit of a rant about the music industry, basically. So, that's, you know, that's what it is.
Just so fat again.
A lot of words in that
one. Yeah, Michael Day comments, he says, I think your music would be fantastic on a Sky TV series. There you go.
Which series?
Yeah. I don't know, they've got quite a few, haven't they, on the go in Sky. Westworld.
Oh, that'd be awesome.
Yeah, Westworld. That's a good one, isn't it? Are you a bit of a science fiction fan?
Definitely, yeah. Yep, anything sci-fi.
You're a sucker for it.
Yeah. Anything kind of futuristic, sci-fi, silly. I think the last series I watched that was good was is it called The Tale of the Avengers? The new Monkey King, which isn't really sci-fi, but it's a...
Fantasy in a way.
Yeah, that was the last proper series I watched, but... what else? Brain's gone. Got my brain's focused.
You like the one with the guy who's the archer or whatever that one.
Yeah, that was last time I was on the show. I did Peterborough's Most Wanted and failed miserably.
Hmm.
Yeah. On Arrow. Yeah.
Yeah.
I can't remember. There's a sci-fi I watched. I'll let you know if it comes back.
If it pops into the brain. Sometimes it's a little bit hard when you're performing performing live music with all your technical setup.
That's
you can get a little blank spot now and again, can't you? Have you ever thought of performing it live in front of an audience?
After 6 days. Dan, who was listening, I think he asked. There's a festival in Lincolnshire, but they were booked up. It's very last minute.
Potentially,
it'd be good to do something like that. Yeah. So, anything that it'd fit.
A bit of a dance festival somewhere like that, isn't it? Yeah. You know? Sort of 11 o'clock at night when all the get the food.
Nothing too crazy. No, I wouldn't mind doing a stage like an outdoor festival or something like that. I'm a bit late for Whittlesea Fair. That's this weekend.
Next year when
I'll have to have
Willow
a Fest.
What about when a Willow Festival comes around again? What about something like that?
Anything like that.
Did you go down there to have a look?
Sorry.
Did you go down to the Willow Festival?
Oh, no, I couldn't for some reason. I think my sister went. But anything like that. Like the Embankment Festival and Strawberry, the other one, Whittlesea Fair and anything. I mean, I've been a local most of my life, you know, so get in touch if you like what you hear and if you feel something. That'd be great.
Something a bit different from the standard rock band, isn't it?
Yeah.
Without a doubt. What's the next one you're going to play for us?
Okay. So this one's called Choices. And, it's really simple, obvious and simple as that. It's...
Choices.
Not any further. It's just as... That's it. The words are really obvious. There's one particular line in it I really like, which is about... it just throws in fame in there, like the whole... Because the whole album's basically about music or an AI, so... It starts off as just general choices, but then it basically reminds you that it's talking about fame and trying to make it and things like that.
Switch the instrument over.
Oh, yeah. What was that? That was about 140 beats a minute, was it?
Yeah.
140 beats a minute. Yeah. Why is 140 beats a minute so important to dance music and stuff like that?
It's changed over the years.
That's it?
Oh, I sounded really posh when I said that. It disappeared. It's changed a lot over the years. When I was at uni, it was turn of 90, and we were told by the course people it was all bang on 120.
Yeah.
You think of those kind of disco bass lines, like all about 120, and like nearly every chart hit that came out for years, Kylie and all of that, 120. But yeah, it sped up so much that they had to half it. So it got, like, in drum and bass and stuff like that, yeah. It got up to something like 170 or whatever. But by the time you get to those figures, it's basically gone back to half the speed again. And it's just the odd bit that you go, oh, that's quite fast. But, you know, it's weird. So, yeah, 140 is kind of... I think most of my fast ones are about 135.
Yeah. Is that sort of connotational to the heartbeat or something like that?
That's what we were told when it was 120, but...
Yeah.
I suspect people's heartbeats are getting faster. No idea.
They might do. As you get a little bit older and a bit more excited, one never knows, do
they? Who knows?
You've had a few beers and you might jump or pogo around or dance at a rave. It could well be. Who knows? So, yeah, 140 beats per second.
Longer slow down, doesn't it?
Yeah, anywhere between 130 and 140, I think, suits me quite... Yeah. Like, I like quite fast rock music, you know, so like quite punky stuff a lot of the time, you know.
I deliberately try and throw it off slightly because everybody does everything at 120, 130, 140. Yeah. So I do 131.
It can be really quite complicated doing electronic music, can't it? Because when you set off your... That sort of, I don't know which way you do it now, if you actually do sit there on the keyboards, or whether you sort of using a computer program now to do it.
There's a guy that does it so well called Kebu, but he uses mostly like old 80s, 90s synth, proper synths, 70s even.
Analog synths.
Yeah, not all of them. He does half digital with some analog thrown in and drums and stuff, but he's got like 20 keyboards around him. You know, full.
Oh, it's a bit of a white one.
Three stacks.
Yeah.
And they're all synced together. Now, to do that, you've just got either be, you know, there must be some crazy kind of MIDI interface or I don't know. But this basically the tempo. I'm not using this really today other than the vocoder at the minute, the funny voice effects. Yeah. But it is actually tempo synced to that. So if I played the sounds on here and arpeggiated for instance, so it would be exactly the right speed to the computer. And the same with this one. Which I'm not using that too much today, it is a little bit, but they are synced. You can tell the computer to like be the master.
Ah.
And anything you plug into it will follow the computer. Or if you've got one keyboard you really like, that could be the master and everything else follows that.
So you've got a master and you've got minions.
They've changed it because it's all this wokeness. You know, it was master and slave, but you're not allowed to say that anymore.
Are you not? Yeah. Oh dear!
They've changed. So yeah, minions works.
There we go.
The master and they're my minions.
There we go. We've solved it. We've solved the political correctness problem.
Absolutely, you know. That's good. I remember that. Welcome to my minions. They obey my command.
How many more you got to play for us, Anthony?
Can we fit two in?
Yeah, two. Do you want to do two in a row, or is that too much to ask you?
It'll be a very slight switch, but I can do that.
Excellent. Let's finish it.
All being well, you know.
We've got confidence in you.
Okay, so this one is basically the title track, so it's AI. I keep forgetting to switch this. There we go.
On to the new. Am I getting through? Is the way that it
Better be, because it's appropriate, it's called One Final Time.
Excellent. That's a good bridge.
I've practiced doing this so smoothly at home now, I can't do it. What was it? One Final Time. There we are. Got it.
Take it, make it, rating.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Ant Nottingham.
Thank you.
Big shout out to Paul Biggins, who's doing the cameras and the mixing this evening. Thank you very much, Paul. This is Alias Kid and a song called Gonna Be a Star.